So it's really a pleasure to present today. And I want to thank the organizers for inviting me for this talk. So as I said, I work since my PhD on the Antarctic surface mass balance. At the beginning, it was only for the recent past, so the last 40 years, reconstructing the Antarctic surface mass balance, and then we've done some projections. So it's my pleasure to present this work. To begin, I wanted to do a reminder of the Antarctic mass balance, what it is and why it is important. So first, you have to know that the Antarctic surface mass balance, in fact, it's all the interaction between the ice sheet and the atmosphere that induce mass change of the ice of the Antarctic ice sheet. So mainly in Antarctica, you have snow accumulation, meaning that you have very few ice loss by surface processes, but you have a huge mass gain by snowfall and fall. I have an echo. On the left, you have a map of the Antarctic surface mass balance. And you can see that it is almost everywhere positive. And it represents, in fact, a large flux that is of about 2,000 gigatons per year of snow accumulating over the ice sheet here. So this is a result of a regional model I use and develop, the model MA, and I will present it later. So this mass, you have a few mass loss by snow melt, but is really reduced to the Antarctic margins. So you have on the right a map of the snow melt in Antarctica for the last 40 years. And in fact, this snow melt, it's really much, much lower than the snow accumulation. And also, most of the melted snow refreezes into the snowpack. So at the end, you have almost no mass loss by snow melt currently. So this mass gain by snow accumulation that we call the surface mass balance, it's compensated by the ice loss by ice fluxes towards the ocean. So that's what I represented here by a map of the ice velocity for Antarctica. So with the brownish and the yellowish colors representing the static ice, and the yellow and the green, blue to purple here is a very ice speed ice, meaning that you have almost like rivers, what we call ice streams, flowing towards the ice sheet margin and finally floating over the ocean. And then, so you have ice removed by this ice discharge. So the two flux between the ice discharge, that is called also ice dynamics, and the surface mass balance, they are of same magnitude. You can see that the ice discharge is just a little higher, 2,200 gigatons per year. It's a little higher than the surface mass balance. So at the end, the change in the total mass of the ice sheet is a small equilibrium between these two ice flux, ice and snow fluxes. It's what is represented here on this graph. You can see in purple the change in mass balance of the ice sheet. That is the sum of, so it's a cumulative change. It is the sum of the surface mass balance in blue and the ice discharge in red. And what we can see here is that over the last 40 years, we have almost stable surface mass balance, but we have an acceleration of the ice discharge. This acceleration of the ice discharge, in fact, is due to processes occurring over ice shelves. The ice shelves are the floating part of the ice sheet that are represented here on the left map by the yellow to blue colors. And in fact, this floating part is retaining the ice flux coming from the grounded part of the ice sheet. So here all is in gray, is grounded over the rock. And if you weaken this small part of the ice sheet that is flow thinning, you can induce large acceleration of the ice flux towards the ocean. And it is a way, it is in fact a way, a way to weaken these ice shelves is to melt them by above, so surface melt, and you can also melt them by below, by ocean melt. Here I will focus on the surface melt. So the surface melt, it occurred over the Antarctic Peninsula, so the northern part of Antarctica, that is represented here on the map. And over this part of Antarctica, we have seen major melting event over the ice shelves, and at the end, it induced the ice shelf collapse on the eastern part of the Antarctic Peninsula. So we know that this kind of event can occur, and we wonder how it can contribute to the mass change of the Antarctic ice sheet over for the future. So at the end, for the future, we want to predict both the snow accumulation, how it will evolve in a warmer climate, and we want to predict how surface melt will evolve, because it can have a major impact on the ice sheet stability. So I begin the first part of my talk, that is about processes affecting the snow accumulation. And I will just focus on one process to be quick. So here on this map, you have the location of the main observation of the surface mass balance. That is mainly observation of the snow accumulation. So on the left, you have ice cores and stack networks in gray and yellow. And on the right, you have stakes. You have stakes and a radar measurements. But at the end, you can see that there are very few observations at the scale of the ice sheet. And if we want a map covering the full ice sheet, we have to use models. So the model I use is a regional climate model, so a regional atmospheric model. That covers the entire Antarctic ice sheet. So the domain of the model is represented on the map on the right. So this model, the MAR model, it was really developed specifically to represent polar regions. It has a detailed snowpack that interacts with the atmosphere through turbulent fluxes and also through drifting snow processes. The MAR model also includes specific processes for the cloud microphysics that are specific to the polar regions. So I will go on. I have to say that it's a regional model. So we have to force this model at the model boundaries represented here. By a global climate model. So this global climate model can be either a reanalysis or a Earth system model for doing projections. So as I said, I will focus on one process here that to illustrate how Antarctica is different from other parts of the world and why we need a specific model for this part of the world. So here you have a representation of the ice sheet here on the right, and on the left you have its interaction with the ocean and the atmosphere. In fact, the large-scale circulation is advecting moist and warm air toward Antarctica, and this is the origin of the Antarctic precipitation. But on the other part, you have a surface flux in Antarctica that goes from inland to the ocean. So this surface flux is usually called katabatic flux, but it's a combination of a real katabatic flux and of a pressure gradient flux, meaning that you have high pressure inland, low pressure over the ocean, so it drives a flux from inland to the ocean. And as the flux is going downward, it creates an adiabatic warming because of the compression of the air. So at the end, you have relatively warm air flowing downward. And this air is also extremely dry. So you have a very warm air, extremely dry. It means that it can hold a lot of moisture. So it has a lot of capacity to sublimate snowflakes. So this lower atmospheric layers have a height of about 1,000 meter, so 1 kilometer at the coast. It evaporates the snowfalls and the snowflakes, and this process is represented in very few models. So in MAR, we have evaluated the MAR models against some observation, and we have seen that the sublimation in the lower atmosphere is quite huge. It represents 360 gigaton per year. That is almost 1 millimeter sea level equivalent. So it's a really huge flux of just snowfall sublimating in the surface layers. And I wanted to develop on other processes such as snow transport by the wind, but I will follow on the rest of my talk. But don't hesitate to ask me questions. So the first part was to illustrate the processes, so the local processes that affect the snow accumulation in Antarctica. But of course, the first thing that affects the accumulation is the large-scale circulation. So in the previous part, I forced MAR with reanalysis, meaning that the large-scale circulation is really well constrained and close to the reality. But what we want to do, in fact, is to do projections of the surface mass balance. So we have to use global climate models to force the regional model over Antarctica to simulate the surface mass balance. And doing this, I realize that if I take a random global climate model, I get really, really bad results for the Antarctic surface mass balance for the current climate. And in fact, it's because most of the global climate models have major biases of large-scale circulation over the Southern Ocean. So the Southern Ocean is a part of the world that is not often looked at, most closely looked at this last years, because we have is really important for the global climate too. But what I did, a large part of my work was to evaluate the large scale field of the global climate model from the CEMIP database to evaluate how good or bad they are for the large scale circulation over Antarctica. So it's what I wanted to represent here on these several maps, and I did a little zoom for one of them here. So here you have an example for one of large scale fields that is a sea level pressure. And you can see the bias here compared to era interim in a mean over a 30-year period. So for each climate models, I can compute this metric for several different large-scale fields. And this way, I can evaluate all the models. And what I do for combining different large-scale fields is to scale each of, so the metric is the RMSE of this map. And I scale the RMSE by the median RMSE of all CEMIP models. And this way, I can combine the metrics and attribute some scores for each of the CEMIP models that are represented here at the bottom. And here, for each model, you can see you have four dots. And in fact, these four dots are different combinations of metrics. And it was to evaluate the robustness of this kind of ranking. So here, I scale all metric by the median. So it means that all models here on the green areas between, so between zero, the perfect model era, the my reference and one, are the model in the first half of the models. And you can see that if you are in the first half of the model, meaning that you are in the best models, it doesn't depend of the metric you use, you stay in the best models. And similarly, if you have a bad score, even with a different combination of metrics, you stay with a bad score. So this way, we decided to select four global climate models from the best half of this ranking. And I will present the results of the projections later. I will go quick on the second part of the large-scale drivers of the Antarctic surface mass balance. But I have to say that here, previously, I evaluated the mean of large-scale field, but we realized a few years ago that, in fact, extremes are really important for the surface mass balance of the Antarctic ice sheet. So, particularly extremes in advection of humidity over Antarctica. So we had, in particular, a focus on the atmospheric rivers that are intense advection of humidity along narrow corridors that is represented on the left map here. So you have the IVT, that is the integrated vapor transport, on the left with the blue. So you can see a narrow corridor of really high transport of moisture toward Antarctica. And you can see here the Antarctic Peninsula. So we have seen that this atmospheric river, they bring a lot of moisture and a lot of heat to Antarctica. So they have a large impact on both the snow accumulation and the snow melt. And we have also seen that this atmospheric river are related to blocking events represented on the right that are in fact stationary high pressure that allow direct the flux toward Antarctica here. So you have a blocking here, and the flux is have to go toward Antarctica in a narrow corridor, and this has a huge impact on Antarctic surface mass balance. So I will not have time to develop this part, and I will jump to projection. But you have to know that it has impact both on snow melt, that is represented here, and in snowfall, and particularly in extreme snowfall events that are represented here on the right map. And finally, I will go to projections of the Antarctic surface mass balance. So we have limited computational resources, so that's why we selected we selected four GCMs from the semi-5 and semi-6 ensemble that are represented in the light line here. So what's represented is the change in near surface temperature in the GCM over the Antarctic region. And so we have two GCM that have very high climate sensitivity here in orange, and two GCM with lower climate sensitivity here in blue. And the bold line are for the mean of semi-5 in blue and mean of semi-6 in red over Antarctica. So what we concluded, so we use this GCM to force MAR, and we computed the surface mass balance. So here, I show is the change in surface mass balance between the end of the 21st century and the end of the 20th century. So red means that you have an increase in surface mass balance, so an increase in snow accumulation over most of the grounded ice sheet. And blue means that you have a decrease in surface mass balance over most of the ice shelf, so over most of the floating ice. And this is because you have an increase in snowfall over the grounded ice sheet, that is the upper map, and an increase in runoff, so in melting, in snow melt, that is not refrozen into the snowpack over the ice shelves. So in the future, you have this really large competition between snow accumulation over the grounded ice sheet and loss of mass over the ice shelves. So we can really wonder about the ice shelf stability in the future. And all of this is closely linked. What is represented here is a link between the change in snowfall in surface mass balance over the grounded ice sheet and the ice shelf, depending on the temperature change in the global climate model. And there is a strong relationship between the two. So I will now conclude. As I already over for the time, I can let this slide and you can ask me question to let time to question. Thank you very much.